الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: قل اللهم مالك الملك تؤتي الملك من تشاء وتنزع الملك ممن تشاء وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, first and foremost, it is incumbent upon all of us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous favors and bounties that He has conferred upon us. And now, coming to the glorious names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we move on to the next name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Al-Malik. The name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Al-Malik. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم الملك. This particular name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explicitly mentioned this title or this name in the Noble Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, فتعالى الله الملك الحق. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Noble Quran, فتعالى الله الملك الحق. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the true King, He is indeed high upon every single thing. Likewise, in another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, Al-mulku yawma'idhin il-haqqu lir-Rahman. That on that day, Allah is referring to the day of Qiyamah. Al-mulk, kingdom, sovereignty will be for Him the most merciful. Now, before we go into that verse, in regard to this name, Al-Malik, there are two other names also which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses. Al-Malik, Al-Malik, likewise Malikul Mulk. Three names. Al-Malik, Al-Malik, and Malikul Mulk. We see in Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Maliki Yawm Al-Din. In another form of recitation, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Malik Yawm Al-Din. So Malik Yawm Al-Din or Maliki Yawm Al-Din is also one of the titles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses. And then Malikul Mulk. Now let's look at the differences between these three names. And likewise, now coming to the ayah that I recited just before Surah Al-Fatiha, Al-Mulku Yawma Idhin Al-Haqqu Lir-Rahman. That the kingdom, the rule, in reality, or the true kingdom will be for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day, for Allah the most merciful. So why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using the word al-haq here, or saying the true kingdom, the true rule, the true power? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Noble Quran, He addresses human beings, in other words, individuals also with this particular name. Because Malik means king. King. So we have kings of this dunya, monarchs of this dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He's talking about Talut, He says in the Noble Quran, Inna Allah qad ba'atha lakum Talut malika. That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He appointed or He sent Talut. This is in the story between Talut, Jalut, during the time of Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam, Goliath. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He sent Talut, or He appointed Talut, Malika. Once again the same word, Al-Malik. We're talking about Allah who is Al-Malik, and now here, Malikan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed him as a king. But now in terms or in regard to the difference between the kings, the monarchs of this world and the all supreme, the all powerful king, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The kings and owners. Now the word Malik means owner. Malik means king, Malik owner. So Maliki Yawmiddin can be translated as the owner of the day of judgment, or Maliki Yawmiddin according to the other kira can be translated as the king of the day of judgment. So the kings and owners of this world, for example, the plot of land that I own, I can say I am Maliku Bayti, or Maliku Hadha Al-Bayt. I am the owner of this piece of land. Or Maliku Sayyara, I am the owner of this car. But in reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of every single atom and molecule on the face of this in this universe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the supreme king. So the difference between the monarchs, the kings, the owners of this world is that even if you were to take a king today, his territory will be limited. His territory would be limited. Even if we had a king who is ruling the whole world, he would only rule planet Earth. What about the other planets? But when we talk about the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is unlimited. The kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is supreme and absolute. His territory is not limited, it is unlimited. And in regard to the human kings and monarchs, they fear losing their seat. They fear that someday they would lose their throne. Human kings and monarchs. And a good example or good examples for that would be Namrud and Fir'aun. They fear that someday they would lose their seat of power, their kingdom. And that is why they claimed for divinity. They claimed that they were God, out of fear that they would lose their seat. So the kings, owners of this world, the monarchs of this world, all of them are temporary. The real, true power, the real kingdom is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on that day, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, when this dunya, when this universe, when every single thing will be destroyed, and only Allah, the Most High, the Most Exalted will remain. Even the Malaika will be destroyed. Even Malakul Maut, after discharging his duty, after carrying out what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had asked him to do, after he executes every single order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even he would perish. And only Allah the Almighty would remain. And on that day, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty will question, لمن الملك اليوم؟ لمن الملك اليوم؟ For whom is the kingdom today? For whom is the true kingdom today? لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ No one would remain to answer that question, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Where will be the kings on that day? Where will be the presidents on that day? Where will the emperors be on that day? Where will the dictators be on that day? Where will all of these superpowers, so-called superpowers, be on that day? None will remain. None will remain to answer that question other than the great king himself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself would answer the question, لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ That day would remain only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one, Al-Qahhar. No other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would remain on that day. So this proves, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the true kingdom belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A beautiful story in regard to Harun al-Rashid, rahimahullah, a very righteous king. He lived in the lap of luxury, castles, fortresses, palaces. This is how his life was. At the throes of his death, he was on his deathbed and he makes a request that he wants to see the qabr, the grave that he is to be buried. His ministers, the people around him, his family, they feel it strange. And they say, what a strange request. He says, he insists, I want to see the grave that I'm going to be, or the place where I'm going to be buried. So the king's request has to be honored. They carry the king. He is in his throes of death. He's on his deathbed. They carry the king, Harun al-Rashid, to the grave that he is going to be buried. The minute he sees that grave, the minute he sees that dark hole, he looks back at his palaces, he looks back at his castles, he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he says, Ya man la yazulu mulkum, Ya man la yazulu mulkum, Ya man la yazulu mulkum. O the one whose kingdom will never destroy, O the one whose kingdom will never perish. Irham man qad zala mulkum, Irham man qad zala mulkum, Irham man qad zala mulkum. Have mercy upon the one whose kingdom is about to be destroyed. Have mercy upon the one whose kingdom is about to be perished. Have mercy upon the one who is going to lose his seat of power. And then he recites these verses of the noble Quran. Ma aghna anni maliyan, ma aghna anni maliyan. What benefit has my wealth provided me on this day? Ma aghna anni maliyan. Oh, my wealth has not benefited me in any way. Ma aghna anni maliya, halaka anni sultaniya. Ma aghna anni maliya, halaka anni sultaniya. My wealth has not benefited me in any way. Halaka anni sultaniya. And likewise, my kingdom has been destroyed. My rule, my power, my authority, nothing is going to avail me on this day. Allahu Akbar. He recites these verses of the noble Quran. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, all of this proves that the kings of today, or the kings of this world, the monarchs of this world, are all seated on seats of power which are temporary. Which are temporary. And the true rule, absolute power, in all its might and supreme belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the next difference in regard to the kings of this world and the king and the supreme and almighty king Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that the kings of this world, if they were to give out from their treasure vaults, if they were to give out from their treasure houses, he may be the most richest man on the face of this earth. But if he were to give out from his treasures, no doubt it is going to reduce. It is going to reduce. Even if he were to give out a dollar, even if he were to give out a single rupee, it is going to reduce. But on the other hand, the khazain of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at this beautiful hadith Qudsi. Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiyallahu anhu narrates. The hadith is recorded in Sahih Muslim. On the authority of Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is a hadith Qudsi. Ya ibadi, O my slaves, Ya ibadi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد. Ponder, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. It is indeed a great hadith. Take a minute and ponder on the greatness of the words of this hadith. لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد. If every single one of you, from the very first of human beings, لو أن أولكم, from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, وآخركم. Until the last human being to come to the face of this earth. We aren't talking about the current population on the face of this earth. A few billion, 7-8 billion, no. From Adam alayhi salatu wassalam, all of the generations, all of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wassalam, all of them, until the last human being to come to the face of this earth. If all of y'all, and not only the human beings, وَجِنَّكُمْ, even the jinnat. Do we know the number of the jinnat? From the very first jinn until the very last jinn, all of y'all, if y'all were to stand in one on a plane, on one plane, فَسَأَلُونِي, and if you are all to raise your hands and supplicate unto me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if you were to ask of me, فَأَعْطَيْتُ كُلَّ ذِي سُؤْلٍ مَسْأَلَتَهُ, and if I were to give every single person his request, every single person, one person may ask for a good vehicle, another person perhaps palaces, kingdoms, houses, land, wealth, name it, every single request, if I were to answer every single supplication and give every single person on that plane whatever they wished and requested, ما نقص ذلك مما عندي, nothing would diminish, nothing would reduce from my treasures, from my wealth, from my treasure houses. إِلَّا كَمَا يَنْقُصُ الْمِخْيَةُ إِذَا أُدْخِلَ الْبَحْرَ, الله أكبر. Other than if you were to, the comparison Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to show that, you know, the insignificance of the reduction in his wealth, in his treasure, it would be as if you dip a tiny needle in the ocean, and if you were to take out the needle, the amount of water that would stick to that needle, at times there would not be any water at all. But that is how much that would reduce from my treasures. Insignificant. Nothing would diminish from the treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the difference between the human Malik and the Al-Malik, the Supreme, the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I hope that I've given you all a few points to ponder on the greatness of the sovereignty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next point that is in line, another few minutes, that no one, not one human being, no one on the face of this earth, from the time of Adam alayhi salatu wassalam until the last human being ever to be born on the face of this earth, no one can ever dare plot against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one. Whoever tried, they were destroyed. No one can try to plot against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in regard to that, we have the story, the narration in regard to Abraha. Abraha, this took place, the incident in regard to the king Abraha. This was in Amul Fil, in the year of the elephant, as it was known. This was the year in which our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was born. Abraha al-Habashi, he was a king, a Christian king, a staunch Christian king, who was from Yemen. He was observing that a huge number of people used to travel every single year to Mecca to visit Kaaba, to visit the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to perform their religious rites. They used to travel to Mecca. Now he, being a staunch Christian, he wanted to attract this very same crowd to his own place of worship. And historians mention that he built a church, a monastery, a place of worship, and he named it Al-Qulais. Al-Qulais. He built a grand church, and he was a king, he ordered a messenger to go to every town to every city announcing that this is the new place of worship that you all need to come every single year. The messenger went around announcing it in every town, every city. Look at the difference. This is the king doing all of this. Whilst Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he and his beloved son Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam built the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all alone. And Allah the Almighty, He says in the Noble Quran, after Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam built the house of Allah, the Kaaba, he was ordered, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. Oh Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, proclaim, stand where you are and call out, give out adhan. Azin, proclaim to the people bilhajj that they come to the Kaaba, to the house of Allah on pilgrimage. يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيقٍ. And what would happen? You proclaim يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, and they will come by foot, وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ, and upon every lean camel, يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيقٍ, and they would come from every distant pass or every distant valley. Allahu Akbar. No big messenger, no town crier going all over the place announcing. Just Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam alone with his sincerity in complying to the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we witness that until today, millions and millions visit those lands. Allahu Akbar. In compliance to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abraha, he builds this church and he announces everybody should come here. But then nobody did. And some of the Arabs were angered at this act of Abraha, and they planned, a group of them traveled discreetly to this new house of worship that Abraha had built, known as Al-Qulays, and they defiled it. They defiled it. Historians mention that perhaps through urine and stool, etc., they defiled his place of worship. News travels to Abraha. He was angered. I built a house of worship. I ordered them to come and worship, but they come and defile it. I announce war, and I am going to destroy the Kaaba. He musters an army of 40,000 strong. He musters an army of 40,000 strong with horses and elephants. Elephants were animals that the Arabs had never witnessed. And he travels from Yemen to Mecca. He travels from Yemen to Mecca with the intention of demolishing the Kaaba. He comes and he camps at the outskirts of Mecca. He sends a small group from his soldiers to capture whatever animals they could see from the camels and horses so that they could increase their number in the army. Now from these camels that they captured 200 camels that belong to Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the leader of the Quraysh at that time. 200 camels. And now he was camped at the outskirts of Mecca. Now the people are in chaos. The Quraysh and the Meccan Arabs, as they had never witnessed such an army with elephants. These animals are so huge, and they find out that his intention is to demolish Kaaba, the Kaaba. They approach Abdul Muttalib and seek his advice in regard to what are we supposed to do. Abdul Muttalib, he says, look, we cannot withstand his army, but the house belongs to a lord, belongs to a king who is indeed supreme and almighty, and he will look after his house. But I seek an audience with this king, Abraha. So the messenger of Abraha, who had come to give the message to the Quraysh that they are intending on demolishing the Kaaba, goes to Abraha and informs him that Abdul Muttalib wishes to meet you, the leader of the Quraysh. Now Abraha, even though he had this determination to destroy the Kaaba, deep within he was worried. Now he says, okay, let Abdul Muttalib come. Abdul Muttalib, he goes. He goes to the camps where they were camped at, and he goes to the camp of Abraha, enters the camp. Abraha was seated on a throne. royal seat as he was the king. The minute he saw Abdul Muttalib, due to his seniority and due to him being the leader of the Quraysh, he was immediately filled with awe. He immediately gets up from his seat, hugs him and asks him to sit down, and he also sits down because he felt awkward to sit on a seat higher than the seat of Abdul Muttalib. Now he was expecting something great from Abdul Muttalib. He was worried, deep within he was scared, he was petrified. Abdul Muttalib, Abraha asked Abdul Muttalib, "What is the purpose of your visit? Why have you come? You know of my intention. I have come here to demolish the Kaaba, and if anybody stands in my way, I will destroy them." Abdul Muttalib, he says, "That is between you and the Lord of that house. I have come because a group from your army have captured 200 of my camels, and I own these camels. I am not the owner of that house. I am not the Malik or the Malik of that house. I am the Malik of my camels. So I come to you requesting my camels. I come seeking justice." Abraha was shocked. He said, "You know what? When I saw you, I stood up out of respect, out of admiration, you being the leader of the Quraysh. I was expecting something greater from you, and you come to me about these petty 200 camels? Whilst I am intending on demolishing the Kaaba?" Abdul Muttalib repeats what he said in the beginning, saying that, "I do not own the Kaaba, I own the camels, so please return them back to me. You sort it out with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Abraha calls the leader, in the sense the commander of his army, and tells him, "Please release the 200 camels and send this man away. We have got better things to do." Abdul Muttalib, he takes the camels and goes towards Mecca. He announces to the people of Quraysh, "Abraha is coming with his army. We cannot withstand the army. Let's all move to the outskirts towards the hills." And whilst everybody was leaving, Abraha, he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect his house. Whilst he was in prayer, and the army of Abraha is advancing to demolish the Kaaba, Abdul Muttalib sees flocks of birds coming. Scholars of Tafasir mention from the direction of Yemen, groups of flocks of birds coming towards Mecca, towards the Kaaba. Abraha's army advancing towards the Kaaba to demolish the Kaaba. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it in the Noble Quran in Surah Al-Fil. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ Did you not see how your Lord, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how the powerful king dealt with the people of the elephants, أصحاب الفيل؟ ألم يجعل كيدهم في تضليل؟ And did you not see how he made their plans go in vain? How he foiled their plans? ألم يجعل كيدهم في تضليل؟ وأرسل عليهم طيرا أبابيل. And he sent birds, أبابيل, in herds, in flocks. They came 40,000 strong. They came with elephants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the powerful king, he does not need something greater than that to defeat them. No, tiny birds. Tiny birds is sufficient for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In regard to Namrud, mosquito is sufficient for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdul Muttalib, he witnesses the birds. They were filling the skies. Everything was becoming dark. So many birds. And he notices something amazing. These birds, he had never seen them in his life. And each bird had three pebbles. Three pebbles, one in its beak and two in each of its claws. Three pebbles, tiny rocks. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ And what did these birds do? Abraha is advancing with his army. Historians mention, scholars of Tafasir, he was on a white elephant. He was speeding towards the Kaaba. These birds cover the army, target each and every soldier, and pest them with these tiny pebbles. تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ Tiny pebbles. It rained down in pebbles. It rained down. This is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdul Muttalib was amazed. He was witnessing the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say afterwards? فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. And what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? He pelted the army of Abraha who came to demolish the Kaaba and made them كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. Like chewed up straw. Like eaten up straw. Elephants, huge army, they became like eaten, chewed up straw. Allahu Akbar. They were strewn all over the place. Destroyed, killed, mutilated. This is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if anybody tries to plan or plot against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, against His deen, against His religion, Allah the Almighty at times would give them some respite to do whatever they are doing. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seizes them with His wrath, His ghadab, it is indeed severe. It is indeed severe. Allah does not need great things to destroy. Mosquitoes, birds, winds, just a scream and Allah can destroy. Allah has destroyed nations. This is the power of Al-Malik. This is the power of Malikul Mulk, the owner, the king of all kings, to whom the supreme sovereign belongs to. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, finally the objective behind studying the glorious names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to internalize these attributes in our lives too. So it is upon us to exercise justice in whatever or in any situation where we are supposed to exercise justice or where we have the opportunity of exercising justice. For only then, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, will the just king have mercy upon all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our good deeds, and likewise may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill our hearts with love for Him, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He united us today, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our deeds. Wa akhir da'wa, yani alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.